क्लास 12th बायोलॉजी चैप्टर 3 ह्यूमन रिप्रोडक्शन। गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, यू आर लुकिंग एट द ऑडियो विजुअल चैप्टर ऑफ बायोलॉजी। आर यू अवेयर ह्यूमंस आर सेक्सुअली रिप्रोड्यूसिंग एंड विविपेरस। द रिप्रोडक्टिव इवेंट्स इन ह्यूमंस इंक्लूड फॉर्मेशन ऑफ गैमेट्स, गैमेटोजेनेसिस दैट इज स्पर्म्स इन मेल्स एंड ओवम्स इन फीमेल, transfer of sperms into the female genital tract, insemination and fusion of male and female gametes, fertilization leading to formation of zygote. This is followed by formation and development of blastocyst and its attachment to the uterine wall, implantation, embryonic development, gestation and delivery of the baby, parturition. You have learned that these reproductive events occur after puberty. There are remarkable differences between the reproductive events in the male and in the female. For example, sperm formation continues even in old men, but formation of an ovum ceases in women around the age of 50 years. Let us examine the male and the female reproductive systems in human. The male reproductive system is located in the pelvic region. It includes a pair of testes along with accessory ducts, glands and the external genitalia. The testes situated outside the abdominal cavity within a pouch called scrotum. The scrotum helps in maintaining the low temperature of the testes 2 to 2.5 degrees centigrade lower than the normal internal body temperature necessary for spermatogenesis. In adults, each testis is oval in shape with a length of about 4 to 5 cm and a width of about 2 to 3 cm. The testis is covered by a dense covering. Each testis has about 250 compartments called testicular lobules. Each lobule contains 1 to 3 highly coiled seminiferous tubules in which sperms are produced. Each seminiferous tubule is lined on its inside by two types of cells called male germ cells, spermatogonia and sertilized cells. The male germ cells undergo meiotic divisions, finally leading to sperm formation, while sertilized cells provide nutrition to the germ cells. The regions outside the seminiferous tubules called interstitial spaces contain small blood vessels and interstitial cells or Leydig cells. Leydig cells synthesize and secrete testicular hormones called androgens. Other immunologically competent cells are also present. The male accessory ducts includes retrotestis, vasa efferentia, epididymis and vas deferens. The seminiferous tubules of testis open into the vasa efferentia through retrotestis. The vasa efferentia leaves the testis and open into epididymis, located along the posterior surface of each testis. The epididymis leads to vas deferens that ascends to the abdomen and loop over the urinary bladder. It receives a duct from seminal vesicle and opens into urethra as the ejaculatory duct. These ducts store and transport the sperms from the testes to the outside through urethra. The urethra originates from the urinary bladder and extends through the penis to its external opening called urethral meatus. The penis is the male external genitalia. It is made up of special tissues that helps in erection of the penis to facilitate insemination. The enlarged end of the penis, called the glans penis, is covered by a loose fold of skin called foreskin. The male accessory glands include paired seminal vesicles, a prostate, and a paired bulbourethral glands. Secretions of these glands constitute the seminal plasma, which is rich in fructose, calcium, and certain enzymes. The secretions of bulbourethral glands also help in the lubrication of the penis. Now let us look at the diagrams. This is the sectional view of a male pelvis showing reproductive system. And labels are as follows: ureter, seminal vesicle, urinary bladder, vas deferens, prostate, penis, urethra, glans penis, and covering the foreskin. Ejaculatory duct, rectum, anus, and the bulbourethral gland. The same labels or the diagram, just from the different view. Pause the video and look at the diagram and memorize the labels in this view as well. This is the diagrammatic sectional view of seminiferous tubule. This is showing sertilized cells, spermatozoa, spermatogonia, and interstitial cells. The female reproductive system. The female reproductive system consists of a pair of ovaries along with a pair of oviducts, uterus, cervix, vagina, and the external genitalia, located in the pelvic region. These parts of the system, along with a pair of mammary glands, are integrated structurally and functionally to support the process of ovulation, fertilization, pregnancy, birth, and childcare. Ovaries are the primary female sex organs that produce the female gamete, ovum, and several steroid hormones, ovarian hormones. The ovaries are located one on each side of the lower abdomen. Each ovary is about 2 to 4 cm in length and is connected to the pelvic wall and uterus by ligaments. Each ovary is covered by a thin epithelium, which encloses the ovarian stroma. The stroma is divided into two zones, a peripheral cortex and an inner medulla. The diagrammatic sectional view of the female pelvis showing uterus and the cervix and then the vaginal orifice. There is urinary bladder, pubic symphysis, urethra, clitoris, labia minora, labia majora, and the rectum, vagina, and the anus. The oviducts or the fallopian tubes, uterus, and vagina constitute the female accessory duct. Each fallopian tube is about 10 to 12 centimeter long and extends from the periphery of each ovary to the uterus. The part closer to the ovary is the funnel-shaped infundibulum. The edges of the infundibulum possesses finger-like projections called fimbriae, which helps in collection of the ovum after ovulation. The infundibulum leads to a wider part of the oviduct called ampulla. The last part of the oviduct, isthmus, has a narrow lumen and it joins the uterus. The uterus is single and is also called a womb. The shape of the uterus is like an inverted pear. It is supported by ligaments attached to the pelvic wall. The uterus opens into the vagina through a narrow cervix. The cavity of the cervix is called cervical canal, which along with vagina forms the birth canal. The wall of the uterus has three layers of tissues: the external thin membranous perimetrium, middle thick layer of smooth muscle myometrium, and inner glandular layer called endometrium that lines the uterine cavity. The endometrium undergoes cyclical changes during menstrual cycle, while the myometrium exhibits strong contractions during delivery of the baby. Let us look at the figure 3.3b. This is the diagrammatic sectional view of the female reproductive system. Frontal view, and this labels like uterine fundus, uterine cavity, and the three layers, which is endometrium, myometrium, and perimetrium, ovary, cervix, cervical canal, vagina, fimbriae, and the fallopian tube, which consists of isthmus, ampulla, and infundibulum. The female external genitalia include mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, hymen, and clitoris. Mons pubis is a cushion of fatty tissue covered by skin and pubic hair. The labia majora are fleshy folds of tissue which extend down from the mons pubis and surround the vaginal opening. The labia minora are pair folds of tissue under the labia majora. The opening of the vagina is often covered partially by a membrane called hymen. The clitoris is a tiny finger-like structure which lies at the upper junction of the two labia minora under the urethral opening. The hymen is often torn during the first coitus or intercourse. However, it can also be broken by a sudden fall or jolt. Insertion of a vaginal tampon, active participation in some sports like horseback riding, cycling, etc. In some women, the hymen persists even after coitus. In fact, the presence or absence of a hymen is not a reliable indicator of virginity or sexual experience. This is a diagrammatic sectional view of the mammary gland. There is ribs, muscle between ribs, which are the intercostal muscles, I guess, and the pectoralis major muscle. Above that, there's fat present in the mammary glands, I guess, around the mammary glands. And there are mammary lobe, then alveolus, then mammary duct, and then ampulla, and then the lactiferous ducts, and then nipple, and around the nipple is areola. The functional mammary gland is characteristic of all female mammals. The mammary gland are paired structures, breasts, that contain glandular tissue and variable amount of fat. The glandular tissue of each breast is divided into 15 to 20 mammary lobes containing cluster of cells called alveoli. The cells of alveoli secrete milk, which is stored in the cavities of alveoli. The alveoli open into mammary tubules. The tubules of each lobe join to form mammary duct. Several mammary duct join to form a wider mammary ampulla, which is connected to lactiferous duct through which milk is sucked out. Gametogenesis. The primary sex organs, the testes in the males and the ovaries in the females, produce gametes, that is, sperm and ovum, respectively, by the process called gametogenesis. In testes, the immature male germ cells, spermatogonia, produce sperms by spermatogenesis that begins at puberty. The spermatogonia, singular spermatogonium, present on the inside wall of the seminiferous tubules, multiply by mitotic division and increase in numbers. Each spermatogonium is diploid and contains 46 chromosomes. Some of the spermatogonia called primary spermatocyte periodically undergo meiosis. A primary spermatocyte completes the first meiotic division, reduction division, leading to formation of two equal haploid cells called secondary spermatocytes, which have only 23 chromosomes each. The secondary spermatocytes undergo the second meiotic division to produce 4 equal haploid spermatids. What would be the number of chromosomes in the spermatids? 23. The spermatids are transformed into spermatozoa by the process called spermiogenesis. After spermiogenesis, sperm heads become embedded in the fertilized cell and are finally released from the seminiferous tubules by the process called spermiation. Spermatogenesis starts at the age of puberty. Due to significant increase in the secretion of gonadotropin-releasing hormone, GnRH, this, if you recall, is a hypothalamic hormone. The increased level of GnRH then acts at the anterior pituitary gland and stimulates the secretion of two gonadotropins, luteinizing hormone LH and follicle-stimulating hormone FSH. LH acts at the Leydig cells and stimulate synthesis and secretion of androgens. Androgens in turn stimulate the process of spermatogenesis. FSH acts on the fertilized cells and stimulate secretion of some factors which help in process of spermiogenesis. Let us examine the structure of a sperm. It is a microscopic structure composed of a head, neck, a middle piece and a tail. A plasma membrane envelops the whole body of the sperm. The sperm head contains an elongated haploid nucleus, the anterior portion of which is covered by a cap-like structure, acrosome. The acrosome is filled with enzymes that help fertilization of the ovum. The middle piece possesses numerous mitochondria, which produce energy for the movement of tail that facilitate sperm motility essential for fertilization. The human male ejaculates about 200 to 300 million sperms during a coitus, of which for normal fertility, at least 60% sperm must have normal shape and size, and at least 40% of them must show vigorous motility. Before going further, let us look at the diagrams we missed. This is the diagrammatic sectional view of a seminiferous tubule, enlarged one. And there is fertilized cell, primary spermatocyte, and then further is secondary spermatocyte, and then the spermatid and the spermatozoa. And this is the diagram of sperm, in which the head, neck and tail is labeled. In the head region, acrosome and nucleus is present. In the neck region is the neck region only, and the middle piece contains mitochondria, energy source for swimming, and there is tail. And the whole structure of sperm is covered by plasma membrane. Sperm released from the seminiferous ducts, tubules, are transported by the accessory ducts. Secretions of epididymis, vas deferens, seminal vesicle, and the prostate are essential for maturation and motility of the sperms. The seminal plasma along with sperms constitute the semen. The functions of the male accessory ducts and glands are maintained by the testicular hormones, androgens. The process of formation of a mature female gamete is called oogenesis, which is markedly different from spermatogenesis. Oogenesis is initiated during the embryonic development stage, when a couple of a million gamete mother cells, oogonia, are formed within each fetal ovary. No more oogonia are formed and added after birth. These cells start division and enter into prophase 1 of the meiotic division and get temporarily arrested at the stage called primary oocytes. Each primary oocyte then gets surrounded by a layer of granulosa cells and is called primary follicle. A large number of these follicles degenerate during the phase from birth to the puberty. Therefore, at puberty, only 60,000 to 80,000 primary follicles are left in each ovary. The primary follicles get surrounded by more layers of granulosa cells, and a new theca are called secondary follicles. The secondary follicle soon transforms into tertiary follicle, which is characterized by a fluid-filled cavity called antrum. The theca layer is organized into an inner theca interna and outer theca externa. It is important to draw your attention that it is at this stage that the primary oocyte within the tertiary follicle grows in size and completes its first meiotic division. It is an unequal division, resulting in the formation of a large haploid secondary oocyte and a tiny first polar body. The secondary oocyte retains bulk of the nutrient-rich cytoplasm of the primary oocyte. Can you think of any advantage for this? I guess for the nutrition of the zygote. Thus, the first polar body born out of the first meiotic division divide further or degenerate. They degenerate actually. At present, we are not very certain about this. The tertiary follicle further changes into the mature follicle or graafian follicle. The secondary oocyte forms a new membrane called zona pellucida surrounding it. The graafian follicle now ruptures to release the secondary oocyte from the ovary by the process called ovulation. Can you identify major differences between spermatogenesis and oogenesis? Sure. The figure 3.7, the diagrammatic section view of the ovary. There's blood vessel and there is primary follicle and primary follicle, and then the tertiary follicle showing antrum, and then the Graafian follicle. The Graafian follicle is getting ruptured and the ovum is released out of the ovary, and the left behind is the structure called corpus luteum. This is the schematic representation of spermatogenesis and oogenesis. In the spermatogenesis, it starts at the puberty, where the spermatogonia undergo the mitosis and differentiation and forms more number of spermatogonia. Some of them are primary spermatocytes, and that primary spermatocyte undergo the first meiotic division or the reductional division and forms secondary spermatocytes. Those secondary spermatocytes further go into the second meiotic division and form spermatids, and then those spermatids are haploid actually, and spermatids undergo differentiation and forms spermatozoa. In the oogenesis, it's bit of complex method oogonia. First, it is in the fetal life. Okay, oogonia undergoes mitosis and differentiation and form primary oocyte, and then the primary oocyte get arrested at the prophase 1. From birth, I mean like after birth, there is no addition or multiplication of the oogonia or the primary oocyte. It just, the number remains same. From birth to the puberty, many number of primary oocyte get degenerated, but at the puberty stage, that first meiotic division get completed prior to ovulation. After the ovulation, before the ovulation, the first meiotic division is completed and the secondary oocyte is formed and the first polar body along with that, and then secondary oocyte undergoes the second meiotic division and forms the ovum and the second polar body. These things are happening in the adult reproductive life. Now comes the menstrual cycle. The reproductive cycle in the female primates, example monkeys, apes and human beings, is called menstrual cycle. The first menstruation begins at puberty and is called menarche. In human females, menstruation is repeated at an average interval of about 28 to 29 days, and the cycle of events starting from one menstruation till the next one is called the menstrual cycle. One ovum is released during the middle of each menstrual cycle. The major events of the menstrual cycle are shown in figure 3.9. The cycle starts with the menstrual phase, when the menstrual flow occurs, and it lasts for 3 to 5 days. The menstrual flow results due to breakdown of endometrial lining of the uterus and its blood vessels, which forms liquid that comes out through vagina. Menstruation only occurs if the released ovum is not fertilized. The lack of the menstruation may be indicative of pregnancy. However, it may also be caused due to some other underlying causes like stress, poor health, etc. The menstrual phase is followed by the follicular phase. During this phase, the primary follicle in the ovary grow to become fully mature Graafian follicle, and simultaneously the endometrium of uterus regenerates through proliferation. These changes in the ovary and the uterus are induced by changes in the levels of pituitary and ovarian hormones. Figure 3.9. Let us look at that also. This is the diagrammatic representation of various events during a menstrual cycle. From the day 1 to 3 or the menstruation, menses is happening, like the blood flow is there. And then there is a follicular phase or the proliferative phase, you can say. At that time, the primary follicle is converting into the mature or the Graafian follicle, and there is LH and FSH surge along with the estrogen spike, At that time, ovulation occurs after the follicle phase, and then the luteal phase starts, or the secretory phase. In the luteal phase, in the ovarian hormones, progesterone increases and the estrogen decreases. LH and FSH are the normal level, and the graafian follicle, or the remnant of the graafian follicle in the ovary, forms the corpus luteum, and that corpus luteum actually secreting the progesterone, and the regressing corpus luteum in the luteal phase, further luteal phase, and the estrogen is increasing further and the progesterone is getting decreased, and the next cycle begins. The secretion of gonadotrophins, LH and FSH, increases gradually during the follicular phase and stimulates follicular development, as well as secretion of estrogens by the graafian follicles. Both LH and FSH attain a peak level in the middle of cycle, about 14th day. Rapid secretion of LH leading to its maximum level during the mid-cycle, called LH surge, induces rupture of graafian follicle and thereby the release of ovum, ovulation. The ovulation, or the ovulatory phase, is followed by the luteal phase, during which the remaining part of the graafian follicle transform as the corpus luteum. The corpus luteum secretes a large amount of a progesterone, which is essential for maintenance of the endometrium, such as endometrium is necessary for implantation of a fertilized ovum and other events of pregnancy. During pregnancy, all events of the menstrual cycle stops and there is no menstruation. In the absence of the fertilization, the corpus luteum degenerates. This causes disintegration of the endometrium, leading to the menstruation, marking a new cycle. In human beings, menstrual cycle ceases around 50 years of age. That is termed as menopause. Cyclic menstruation is an indicator of a normal reproductive phase and extends between menarch and menopause. There is menstrual hygiene. This yellow box actually important, I guess, because they have added it in the new NCRT. So maintenance of a hygiene and sanitation during menstruation is very important. Take bath and clean yourself regularly. Use sanitary napkins or clean homemade pads. Change sanitary napkins or homemade pads after every 4 to 5 hours as per the requirement. Dispose of the used sanitary napkins, properly wrapping it with a used paper. Do not throw the used napkins in the drain pipe or toilet or in the open area. After handling the napkin, wash hands with soap. Fertilization and implantation. During copulation or coitus, semen is released by the penis into the vagina, or insemination. The motile sperms swim rapidly, passes through the cervix, enter into the uterus, and finally reach the ampullary region of the fallopian tube. The ovum released by the ovary is also transported to the ampullary region, where fertilization takes place. Fertilization can occur if the ovum and sperms are transported simultaneously to the ampullary region. This is the reason why not all copulation lead to fertilization and pregnancy. The process of fusion of sperm with an ovum is called fertilization. During fertilization, a sperm comes in contact with the zona pellucida layer of the ovum and induces changes in the membrane that block the entry of additional sperms. Thus, it ensures that only one sperm can fertilize an ovum. The secretions of the acrosome help the sperm enter into the cytoplasm of the ovum through the zona pellucida and the plasma membrane. Let us look at the diagram first. Ovum surrounding the few sperms, and there is like ovum. Outside the ovum, there is pre-vitelline space, and then there is zona pellucida layer. Around the zona pellucida layer, there is cells of corona radiata. Okay. Now, this induces the completion of the meiotic division of the secondary oocyte. Entering of the sperm into the ovum induces the completion of the meiotic division of the secondary oocyte. The second meiotic division is also unequal and results in the formation of a second polar body. and a haploid ovum or ooted. Soon the haploid nucleus of the sperm and that of the ovum fuse together to form a diploid zygote. How many chromosomes will be there in the zygote? Obviously, in the case of humans, it is 46. One has to remember that the sex of the baby has been decided at this stage itself. Let us see how. As you know, the chromosome pattern in the human female is XX, and that is in the male is XY. Therefore, all the haploid gametes or ova produced by the female have the sex chromosome X, whereas in the male gametes or the sperm, the sex chromosome could be either X or Y. Hence, 50% of sperm carry the X chromosome while the other 50% carry the Y. After fusion of the male and a female gametes, the zygote would carry either XX or XY. Depending on whether the sperm carrying X or Y fertilized the ovum, the zygote carrying XX would develop into a female baby and XY would form a male. That is why scientifically it is correct to say that the sex of the baby is determined by the father, not by the mother. The meiotic division starts as the zygote moves through the isthmus of the oviduct called cleavage towards the uterus and forms 2, 4, 8, 16 daughter cells called blastomeres. The embryo with 8 to 16 blastomeres is called a morula. Figure 3.11e. Let us look at the diagram 3.11, transport of ovum, fertilization, passage of a growing embryo through fallopian tube. A diagram is a zygote, I guess. It's the ovum. B is their fertilization is occurring and the zygote is formed, and C is the two cell zygote stage, embryo stage, and then D is the four cell stage. Morula is 8 to 16 cell stage, and then the blastocyst. Morula, after morula there is gastrula, and gastrula ke baad there is blastocyst, and that blastocyst get implanted in the endometrial lining of the uterus. Into an outer layer called ectoderm and an inner layer called endoderm. A mesoderm soon appears between the ecto and endoderm. These three layers give rise to all tissues in adults. It needs to be mentioned here that the inner cell mass contains certain cells called stem cells, which have the potency to give rise to all the tissues and organs. What are the major features of embryonic development at various months of pregnancy? The human pregnancy lasts 9 months. Do you know how many months pregnancy lasts in dogs, elephants, cats? Find out. In human beings, after 1 month of pregnancy, the embryo's heart is formed. The first sign of growing fetus may be noticed by listening to the heart sound carefully through the stethoscope. By the end of the second month of pregnancy, the fetus develops limbs and digits. By the end of 12 weeks or the first trimester, most of the major organ systems are formed. For example, the limbs and external genital organs are well developed. The first movement of the fetus and appearance of hair on the head are usually observed during the fifth month. By the end of about 24 weeks or the second trimester, the body is covered with fine hair, eyelids separate, and eyelashes are formed. By the end of 9 months of pregnancy, the fetus is fully developed and is ready to delivery. Parturition and lactation. The average duration of a human pregnancy is about 9 months, which is called gestation period. Vigorous contraction of the uterus at the end of pregnancy causes expulsion or the delivery of the fetus. This process of delivery of the fetus is called the parturition. Parturition is induced by a complex neuroendocrine mechanism. The signals for parturition originate from the fully developed fetus and the placenta, which induce mild uterine contractions called fetal ejection reflex. This triggers a release of oxytocin from the maternal pituitary. Oxytocin acts on the uterine muscle and causes stronger uterine contractions, which in turn stimulates further secretion of oxytocin. The stimulatory reflex between the uterine contraction and oxytocin secretion continues, resulting in stronger and stronger contractions. This leads to expulsion of the baby out of the uterus through the birth canal, parturition. Soon after the infant is delivered, the placenta is also expelled out of the uterus. What do you think the doctors inject to induce delivery? I guess the oxytocin. The mammary glands of the female undergo differentiation during pregnancy and starts producing milk towards the end of the pregnancy by the process called lactation. This helps the mother in feeding the newborn. The milk produced during the initial few days of the lactation is called colostrum, which contains several antibodies absolutely essential for to develop resistance for the newborn babies. Breastfeeding during the initial periods of infant growth is recommended by doctors for bringing up a healthy baby. Summary: humans are sexually reproducing and viviparous. The male reproductive system is composed of a pair of testes, the male sex accessory ducts and the accessory ducts, and external genitalia. Each testis has about 250 compartments called testicular lobules, and each lobule contains 1 to 3 highly coiled seminiferous tubules. Each seminiferous tubule is lined inside by spermatogonian sertilized cells. The spermatogonia undergo meiotic divisions leading to sperm formation, while sertilized cells provide nutrition to the dividing germ cells. The Leydig cells outside the seminiferous tubules synthesize and secrete testicular hormones called androgens. The male external genitalia is called penis. The female reproductive system consists of a pair of ovaries, a pair of oviducts, a uterus, a vagina, external genitalia, and a pair of mammary glands. The ovaries produce the female gamete or ovum and some steroid hormones, ovarian hormones. Ovarian follicles in different stages of development are embedded in the stroma. The oviducts, uterus, and vagina are female accessory ducts. The uterus has three layers, namely perimetrium, myometrium, and endometrium. The female external genitalia includes mons pubis, labia majora, labia minora, hymen, and clitoris. The mammary glands are one of the female secondary sexual characteristics. Spermatogenesis results in the formation of sperms that are transported by the male accessory ducts. A normal human sperm is composed of head, neck, and a middle piece, and a tail. The process of formation of a mature female gamete is called the oogenesis. The reproductive cycle of a female primate is called menstrual cycle. Menstrual cycle starts only after attaining sexual maturation or puberty. During ovulation, only one ovum is released per menstrual cycle. The cyclical changes in the ovary and the uterus during menstrual cycle are induced by changes in the levels of pituitary and ovarian hormones. After coitus, sperms are transported to the junction of the isthmus and ampulla, where the sperm fertilizes the ovum, leading to formation of a diploid zygote. The presence of X or Y chromosome in the sperm determines the sex of the embryo. The zygote undergoes repeated mitotic division to form a blastocyst, which is implanted in the uterus, resulting in pregnancy. After 9 months of pregnancy, the fully developed fetus is ready for delivery. The process of childbirth is called parturition, which is induced by a complex neuroendocrine mechanism involving cortisol, estrogens, and oxytocin. Mammary glands differentiate during pregnancy and secrete milk after childbirth. The newborn baby is fed milk by the mother or the lactation during the initial few months of the growth. Here the chapter ends. I guess you like the video and may help you to increase your memory folds, actually what I claim, and would help you to recall the things easily. If you like it, then please share and subscribe too. Thank you.